And Lyland, I want to stay with you. Eleri Sean with you here on BBC Radio Wales. And it has been a little bit nippy lately, hasn't it? A few of us have seen snow. Not all of us, but a few of us. But it's been positively balmy weather for my next guest, a hardened adventurer who recently conquered an unclimbed mountain in Nepal, the Nafu Peak, in temperatures as low as minus 46 in the wind chill. Well, this weekend you can watch a film of his adventures, but right now Brian Jackson is in our studio in Wrexham. I'm hoping he's had a cup of tea and he's lovely and cutched up, and he's going to talk to us about his adventure. Hello, Brian. How are you?
Hello, Larry. I'm good, thank you.
Good. So, how cold is minus 46?
Incredibly cold. The ambient temperature was about minus 25, but it was the wind that really hurt us on that day.
Oh, my goodness me. Well, we'll talk a little bit later now about what you wore, OK? And but what I want to know is, how do you set this kind of climb up? Because you're an experienced climber. How many mountains and peaks have you climbed over the years?
Oh, my word, that's quite hard to say.
Is it?
I've been up Kilimanjaro 19 times. I've climbed all the 4,000-metre peaks in the Alps. That's 162 of those. And then obviously been up Snowdon a few times and a few other peaks as well.
Goodness me. So those tracks would have been tracks that you would have followed by previous climbers and mountaineers and adventurers. How do you go about planning something like this, you know, an unconquered peak when there isn't an established route up that mountain?
I mean, the first thing you do is you get in contact with the Nepalese government. They have a list that comes out every 9 to 10 years of all the unclimbed or officially unclimbed peaks. Obviously, then you have to do a bit of research, because just because they're officially unclimbed doesn't mean that somebody's done them without a permit. So the idea is to look for peaks that are in areas that maybe haven't been opened up to trekkers before, and possibly areas where the Maoists were, where there are regional problems, so people wouldn't have been there, or peaks that aren't en route to a bigger summit, so they're not used as acclimatisation peaks.
So when you do your research and then you send that letter to the Nepalese government, they're probably saying, oh, it's Brian Jackson from Wrexham again. Are you on first name terms with people in the government out there?
Not precisely on first name terms,
right,
but I do know some of the top Sherpas out there.
Right.
And obviously, we have been going back to the Ministry of Tourism a few times now, so they do recognise you, yes.
So, on top of everything else, the area was hit by a snowstorm not long after your arrival, something you can't plan, of course. How much more challenging was it? You know, forget about it being minus 46. What else were you confronted with?
Well, yeah, just before we left, actually, it was covered on the local news and obviously on international news with regards to the 42 people who died on the Kanglar Fedi, so on the pass.
Oh, I wanted to ask you about that, because did that not put you off?
Basically, the Thoranglar, obviously these people died, and we had to discuss whether we still wanted to go, whether it was actually right still to go. And we decided that it was still right to go. We were going to be in a similar region in the Annapurnas. So when we were there, there was still 5.5 foot of snow, which actually did impact the route that we took to get to the peak and obviously on the summit day itself.
Yeah. So did you have to pack more kit then?
We didn't pack any more kit. But what happened was because we were using mules to get us to base camp, we couldn't go in via the route we wanted to from the east. So we decided to actually go in via the south, which was a totally different route in. So our plans were changing as we were actually trekking in.
Oh, my goodness me. What do you get out of this? Obviously, the challenge is there to climb an unconquered mountain. But there must be instances when you think, is this going to be my last climb?
There weren't any of those.
No.
Thank goodness.
Right.
No, I mean,
That's a positive then, Brian.
Yeah, I'm always positive. for me, it's about walking where nobody's ever walked. And obviously getting to the summit is a bonus. And there's a lady out there called Elizabeth Hawley who actually registers all new climbs, new routes. And she's been doing that for 40, 50 years in Nepal. And when we went to meet her to register the climb before we set off, she said, you know, the three things that you need to think about and you need to focus on is staying healthy, having fun, and you need to return.
Yeah.
And then the fourth thing, if you get it, is a summit. That's just a great bonus. And for us, it was exactly that. As soon as we stepped off the path, as soon as we went beyond where the yak herders go, we were walking on uncharted territory, virgin territory, and that in itself blows your mind. So then obviously to be able to get to the summit as well is just very, very special. And I was doing it specifically for a local charity, a local hospice. So there was sort of, you know, more pressure on me in some ways, but also more drive for me to get to the top.
Yes, you were raising money for the Nightingale House Hospice in Wrexham. But you're with a group of people who are also raising money. How many were you in this? How many were in this group with you?
There were six of us all together.
All right, not a large group.
No, you try and keep the groups as small as possible for this sort of thing because it's so different.
And how many nights did you sleep en route?
To get there, we trekked in for 19 days was in total actual trekking.
Okay. And I suppose, spending the night en route to your climb, how much sleep do you get?
You actually spend quite a lot of time in your tent. You don't sleep the higher you get up, but you do spend a lot of time in your tent because, you know, that we haven't. You've got your tent lights and your torches, but actually when it gets dark, you normally are in your tent because it gets cold very, very quickly. So you're in your tent for maybe between 10, 11 hours a night. So you do a lot of reading on the Kindle. But the higher you get up, your sleep actually becomes less and less. So, for example, the night before summit night, I went to bed at 8 o'clock, if you like, into the sleeping bag, but I probably didn't sleep more than 1 or 2 hours, and we got up at 1 o'clock. So,
going back to this Kindle, how do you recharge it?
Fortunately, the Kindles last for a couple of months, so they're actually fine.
Oh, okay, all right.
So, yeah. But we do carry solar chargers with us for all the rest of our gear, so for the satellite telephone and for the cameras, etc.
And how many miles do you cover each day? Usually.
Well, that's a hard one, actually, because we don't normally measure it in miles because we're doing it sort of hours. We're walking between 5 and 10 hours a day on average to get into it. But you're probably talking between 14 and 24 kilometres on walking in. And then obviously the higher up you go, that distance becomes less and less.
Mm. And the higher you go, the colder it gets. So how do you dress for a climbing expedition like this?
At the bottom, obviously, you're starting off. You can start in shorts. It's beautiful weather. It can be, you know, plus 20s quite easily. And then the further up we get, it gets down to about minus 25 ground temperature. So then you're wearing your thermals and your down jacket and your hood and you've got a hat on. You've got double gloves and you're wearing double boots. So you're wrapping up as much as possible.
Yeah. You know what, that's what I'm going to be wearing at the Millennium Stadium tomorrow night.
Yes.
Because they've decided to keep that roof open.
That's correct. Yeah, I believe the English have asked for it to be kept open.
Yes, great. Typical. The English have decided to spoil it again for us Welsh. So when you do these expeditions, you have been involved in the past with lots of big names in sport, haven't you? Come on, this is your time to name drop now, Brian.
Okay. I was very fortunate to be working with Brian Robson and Kevin Moran from Manchester United fame, and I led them to the summit of Kilimanjaro, not last year, but the year before in October. That was fantastic. And then also that year, worked with Mike Gatting and a few Olympians on the Ashes Cycle Challenge, which was cycling through all the Ashes test grounds. And I'll be working with Darren Goff this year doing the same sort of challenge for the Lord Taverners charity.
Oh, you do a bit of everything then. It's not all, you know, getting on a plane to Nepal and climbing an unconquered mountain.
No, that's sort of the, not to make a pun, but that's sort of the peak of what we do with regards to the expeditions. But we also do things like Three Peaks, London to Paris. They're all charity challenges and charity expeditions.
You know what? I saw on the internet last night a challenge, a marathon throughout the vineyards of France. Now then, I fancy doing that in September. Do you want to join me on that one?
I don't know if I could do a marathon, actually.
Well, I think there's a lot of stopping off and drinking wine.
Oh, then that sounds quite good, yeah.
Dehydration could be a problem, Brian, but I'm sure we could get round that one.
We'd work something in.
Yes. Going back to these superstars then, do they moan a little bit more than us normal folk?
I know you want me to dish the dirt here, but funnily enough, I think because they're used to training hard and they're used to that sort of, you know, being pushed, that actually mentally they're very, very tough.
Okay.
And that's what you need on these challenges, because there are times when you feel great. There will be times when you don't feel so great on each day. And it's about that mental toughness, because, you know, most people who can walk think they can get to summit Kilimanjaro, but then, you know, when actually you're walking up at night and it's maybe 2, 3 a.m. and it's very cold, it's about mental toughness.
Yeah. Well, let's talk about the premiere then of the film this Saturday night. Tell us a little bit more about it, because it's going to be in the Wrexham area in case somebody wants to see it.
Yeah, it's going to be at the Community Church on Prices Lane in Wrexham. Starts at 7 p.m. It's completely free to come and see it. There'll be free tea and coffee. Nearly the whole team are going to be there, so there's going to be 5 out of the 6 people there from all over the UK, so people can ask questions afterwards.
Oh, wonderful.
And we've put together a 40-minute film of the walk-in and the summit day, and then obviously the flying out at the end, so hopefully that will raise more money for Nightingale House Hospice, because there'll be buckets there for people to put money in, and we're also selling some kit that we brought back from Nepal. And any money made from that will go to Nightingale House Hospice.
Oh, you're a great man. Thank you very much for talking to us this afternoon. And how much did you raise for the Nightingale House Hospice?
So far, we're up to about £1,100, but we hope to make that up to £2,000 on the night on Saturday.
Oh, great stuff. What's next? Anything else in the diary, Brian, before we leave you?
There are a few things in the diary, but my next big challenge like that is we have another unclimbed peak that we're going to try and do this November as well. So we're going to try and raise money again.
So many unclimbed peaks out there waiting for you, Brian. Maybe
there
I'll
are.
Join you on one of them, OK?
That'd be superb.
OK, I can't get up the hill in Barry, actually, and Barry's pretty flat by the coast. But anyway, we'll try it. Hey, Brian, thank you very much. And you can see Brian Jackson's film at a free viewing this Saturday night from 7 o'clock at the Community Church, Prices Lane in Wrexham.